Hey guys, so we are here to present SecureMeDroid at AppSec, and let's begin.
So SecureMeDroid as Dawson, right? Yeah, okay, all right. So as he mentioned, this is an Android app that scans other Android apps. On a more technical note, this is an app designed to help Android users improve the security posture of their existing devices. And how it does that, what it is, what's the architecture all about, et cetera, that's something which we'll talk about in the next 40, 45 minutes. Okay? Questions, you can probably ask them as we go along. If they warrant a long answer, we'll probably wait till the end. If they are something quick, we'll just address them right then and there. Okay?
So something about myself. My name is Abhini Jairaj. I am a security consultant at Security Compass. And basically, I've been in the industry professionally for 2 years or so. And I've always been active in web, mobile, and infrastructure security. Recently, with all the hype going on with Internet of Things, I've been into that too. And research and development is one of the keen things that I love to do. And that's why we have SecureMeDroid being presented right now. I'm a quick and dirty coder, so I love to code and automate stuff. All the security testing that we do, I like to automate it so that I don't have to do it again and again.
I'd like to say something here. He does that and then he forgets where he keeps the code.
Yeah.
We had that very, very moment.
So there have been situations I have to actually write code 5 times because I keep on losing it, so that's bad on me. And yes, I'm a proud OSCP certified, so all thanks to OFSEC for that.
Who's this? Oh, that's me. Okay. Name is Vishal Asthana. I currently handle the India operations for the company, and I'm also representing the company on a not-for-profit organization called SafeCode, which is Software Assurance Forum for Excellence in Code, on their TLC, which is the Technical Leadership Council. Interest-wise, it's not quick and dirty coding. I like to write neat codes, which is why I never get to writing code. Okay. Preventive security is something which is very dear to my heart and will always be. So how do you bake security into the software is something which I very closely identify with. When I don't feel like working, then that's when I'm volunteering. You see some of the names there. So one of them is OWASP Delhi chapter. So I kind of co-lead that. And then there is another organization called NULL. And I'm also the founder member of the IAC Square Delhi chapter.
Let's talk about where it actually started. I'd like to thank Vishal for that because he's the guy who started it, and there's no point for me to describe it. So why don't you take that?
Okay. Any ideas what this is? Do we want to give? What's that? Damn it! We just met, man. We didn't even tell you this, right? So yes, it is actually peak traffic driving conditions in Delhi/National Capital Region where our India operations are. And the story is rather interesting. So one fine day, the India operations, when it was basically myself and Abhinit, we were on our way to the office, stuck in traffic. And then we had an engagement, like a client engagement, that got canceled at the last minute. Now, in our company, there is a very good culture of you can do side projects or R&D when you don't have any active billable work. Okay? So, well, we weren't thinking about that aspect, but I started cribbing to Abhinit about, I'm an Android user, and so is he. So I'm cribbing to him about, I have this Avast mobile security on my phone, and it doesn't have this simple feature. When I'm installing stuff, when I'm installing other apps, can't it just tell me that you are installing an app with some known vulnerabilities? And that's it. Then he liked the idea. We started discussing. One thing led to the other, and today we are in front of you talking about the app itself. So it was something which absolutely started as a side project. We didn't expect it's going to turn into an app, and the least we expected was to actually show up here and present that. So that's how the story goes.
So this is how Secure Midroid actually is. I'll understand if you are not able to understand what this actually is. But by the end of the presentation, the first part is what I'm focusing on. I want Secure Midroid on each and every Android user, just to know better how many of you are actually Android users. That's still a joke. Let's go forward.
Okay, yeah, that was like 10 minutes into the presentation. Right?
Oh, yeah. Let's get to know Secure Midroid better. Secure Midroid is what we are going to talk about. So Secure Midroid is an Android application. It is not an antivirus. Let me clear that out. Secure Midroid is not an antivirus. It is different from an antivirus and has something which antiviruses don't have. So it can actually scan installed applications or applications which get updated on your device for known vulnerabilities, which antiviruses don't do. So if you install an application which has a vulnerability in it, Secure Midroid can actually scan that application, find that vulnerability, and let you know about it. Now, since we are finding vulnerabilities, there should be a source of vulnerabilities, and that's where CVE comes in. How many of you are aware of what CVE is? Quite a number of people. Since you know that, I'm going to skip that. And yes, this is one of the key features of the application which help the application run and get the feature that Vishal was talking about. How actually Secure Midroid started? When the idea came in, the first thing, and being a lazy person, what we did was look for existing solutions. Yeah. So we never expected to write an application for solving that problem that we had. We actually looked for solutions that could solve that problem for us and not write an application. But fortunately or unfortunately, we didn't find it. We had to actually write our own solution and do something about it. We came across quite a number of applications, but none of them had that one feature that we were looking for, and we had to actually come up with Secure Midroid. Perfect. Yeah, I wanted to focus on that image right now. How many are familiar with this image or what it wants to say?
Let them focus, man.
Sure.
4.5, 4.75, 5, 6.
Quite a number of people. I think your focus is on the permissions. Is it right? Yeah, so this is a battery application which is trying to access quite a number of things and send and receive SMS. I don't think so it will send an SMS to my girlfriend. Let's see, so Android applications have one key feature, which is permissions.
Question, disclosed girlfriend or undisclosed girlfriend?
Let's keep it a secret. I see quite a number of ladies in here. Yeah, so, since it is Android permissions and we have an Android application, obviously Secure Midroid is related to Android permissions. That's where it comes into secure by design. Since we are security professionals, we have looked into security of the application itself and we have implemented an idea called secure by design. So when you actually design the application, you keep security in mind and make sure that whatever you implement is secure and the user never gets exploited, or even if it gets exploited, it does not impact the user too much. So when the application runs, it requires just two permissions for working, and that's it. So we have two permissions which are required. One is a network access. Since Secure Midroid works on a client-server architecture, we need network permissions. We need to contact a server, which will help the application actually work. So that's the reason we have network access. That's it. Secret. Then we have boot completed. How many of you are using an antivirus which has a scheduled scanner in it?
No. Backtrack. How many of you are using an antivirus?
Yeah. So most of the antiviruses have a scheduled scanner in it. So that's very similar to what we have in Secure Midroid too. We have a scheduled scanner, and that's why we need boot completion permissions so that Secure Midroid can actually run when the application or your phone reboots. That's the reason we have these two permissions. Apart from that, we don't need any permissions at all. So in the beginning, I mentioned that we have a client-server architecture. You must be wondering, if there is a client-server architecture, then what we are trying to transmit over to our server or anything of that sort. Let me vouch for that. We are not accessing any of the sensitive information. How many of you can actually read the 4 points in the image? Quite a number. For those who cannot read it, the application actually accesses 4 key informations, which is package name, application version, and text and a string. So that's the information that we need for finding vulnerabilities using CVE. That's it. And that's actually public information, so nothing private. No. So if you're finding vulnerabilities, there should be an option for user to get to know about it. So whenever application gets scanned, there is some result which gets generated. So when a result gets generated, the user has 3 options. Either they can uninstall that vulnerable application, or they can update it over Google Play Store, which is one of the most popular places to update applications. Or you say that I'm going to keep this vulnerable application and let someone exploit me and go with keep using the application. That's completely up to you.
I think we should, once we're done with this, we should go back to the initial architecture slide, because
yeah,
it'll help you relate
things. Yes, we'll get back to that too. Now, when there is an uninstall option, there should be an option to disable that application. Why do you want me to uninstall the application? So if you want to disable the application, you need a specific permission, which is device administrator. If my application is a device administrator and it gets exploited, your device gets exploited really bad. Really, really bad.
The salad was heavy, right? The lunch salad? Yes, no? No? Everybody awake? Yeah. Okay. I didn't find it to be heavy, so I just wanted to make sure. Right, go ahead.
That's why we are not asking users to disable the application, because it will actually require one of the permissions, which is, which, if exploited, can harm the user very bad. Just uninstall the application and not disable it. And you don't have to go through any of the hassle of it, because from the application itself, SecureMe Droid, you can uninstall the application.
Any questions so far? No? That means they're not explaining anything?
Have you ever seen the image in the right on your Android device or noticed it? Do you see something interesting on it? Apart from the screenshot, yeah. So if you see, it has set auto update over Wi-Fi. So that means this is the default setting in Android. If you don't change it, this is what Android does. What we have seen is most of the people are connected to mobile data, which is 3G, 4G, and not over Wi-Fi. So when you're connected over mobile data, your applications never get updated. So if I'm connected to mobile data for 1 month, then for 1 month, my applications never get updated. If my applications never get updated and something vulnerable comes in, I'm exploitable. So we took that liberty from the user. The application, SecureMe Droid works on mobile data and Wi-Fi by default. You cannot actually disable it. There is one way to disable it, but we'll get to that in the end. So the application works on mobile data and Wi-Fi both. So whenever you are connected to the network, your applications do get scanned for vulnerabilities and you are let know about it. So if you are connected to internet, you are secure. Or SecureMe Droid can help you get secure. That's the idea behind it. You want to talk about that?
Right. internals. I don't know anything about the internals. Which are okay. So there is, yeah, the app does scanning. Supports three types. One is you could have apps that are already like pre-installed, already installed apps. The second is you've just installed them. And the third is you have existing apps on your Android devices and you're updating them. So SecureMe Droid would actually take care of all the three scenarios, okay? Now, when you're scanning, one of the things we found was that the reference database which we have, which is the CVE database or the NVD database, that is for a lot many years. So we said, hey, can we use this in a way where we provide an option to the user to choose the level of depth they want from the data? So what that essentially means is that if you want to go with a basic low intensity scan, you would only be looking at 1 year of NVD data, as in our app would actually be looking at only 1 year. And then as you add one more year, we go all the way up to 5 years. And at that time, if you're doing a scan which requires our app to look at 5 years of data, then that's basically an intense scan. And needless to say, or rather, let me ask you this, any thoughts on what would happen if I move from a low intensity scan to a high intensity scan? It takes longer. It was a simple one, yeah, it actually takes longer. So if your scanning time is longer, it's because you're now looking at 5 years of data instead of 1 year of data. You want to add anything here?
Yeah, it's like if I have to go to my neighbor's home, that would be low intensity. But if I have to go to Canada, then it's a high intensity. The amount of travel which is required from going one place to another, depending upon how far or intense it is, that's how scan depth works. Hello, lazy people. This feature is for you. Schedule scan. So if you don't want to do it again and again, and you want SecureMe Droid to actually work on its own and find vulnerabilities for you and let you know about it, this is the feature for you. Just set it to monthly, weekly, yearly, or whatever you want, and then SecureMe Droid will actually happily scan your applications and let you know when a vulnerability is found. We won't bug you if no vulnerability is found, so don't worry about that. The interesting part, the actual internals. That was the small part. So SecureMe Droid, it would have been impossible to get to the user's device. It was never on Play Store. So if you want to install the application, it is available over Play Store. But if you want to see something cool, that's the website you want to visit. That's the actual website of the product. You can visit it. And I forgot to mention, it's free.
Not just because we are employees of the company, but actually from a design perspective, they've done a fantastic job. So if nothing else, check out the website. You can get some ideas for yourself.
Yeah, you visit Google Play Store every now and then. How often do you visit this website? Just check it out, yeah. The website can redirect you to Google Play Store too, so check out the website. That would be better. So for the application to actually work on the device, it's really simple. You have to install it. If you don't install it, how will the application actually work? I see phones popping up. You can even do that later on after the presentation. Yeah, so as I mentioned, I'll just give a quick recap of that. SecureMe Droid can actually detect or scan applications on your device. So there are like different types of applications on an Android device. There are pre-installed applications. There are new applications that you install, and there are applications which actually get updated. SecureMe Droid can actually scan all the three types of it. And one more thing that I can add is if you actually install an application using APK and not using Play Store or Amazon or whatever, still the application gets scanned. So the application, if it is on your device, it will get scanned. The most important part that I said, yeah, okay. I said I get lost very easily, so that's one part of it. So this is the data which gets accessed from the application.
So we are having a jet lag, just so you know. The distance from India to here is a lot. So we were revising, we were doing things, and if you see that some things are off, blame it on the Air Canada,
yeah. So since it is a client-server architecture, many of you who might be a security professional, you might be worried about how secure the connection is. So we have HTTPS connection between the Android client and the secure Android server. So your data actually never gets hijacked or can never get hijacked. And even the response which comes back from the server cannot be changed. Or if it gets changed, we have some stuff implemented in the application, so you are quite safe. So again, for finding vulnerabilities, we have CV. We don't DOS the NVD database, the server of NVD. We actually pre-gather the data from the server of NVD and cache it in our own server and then use it for analysis. We are not DOSing NVD if someone is from that department. Results. So if you scan an application, only two things can come up. You're good to go or you're not so good to go. If you're good to go, let's smile. And if you're not so good to go, you have three options that I mentioned in the beginning. Uninstall the application, update the application, or hit me hard and keep the application on my device. Everyone good with this part till now? Sure. So the thing is, this question has been asked quite a number of times, and we had the same thought. There are two options to it. Do the analysis on user's device, or do the analysis on a server. If I do the analysis on your device will get heated up. And if I download NVD database on your device, your data consumption will go off the roof. You don't want 500 MB of data downloaded on your device. Yeah, that's what I mentioned. If you see the image, these four details only get access from your device. It's not your user device ID or your username or your Gmail account or anything. I can vouch for it. These are the four things that get accessed on your from your device. That's it. If you can find anything else, do let us know, because that's not Secure Medroid or some other application. So if you have paid applications on your phone, and so they might be having all these four information for sure, because that's compulsory for an Android application. It gets accessed, it gets sent to the server, and one more thing, nothing gets stored on the server too. So if it is a paid application and it gets and its data gets sent to the server, we don't store it. We don't store it at all. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yeah, so this thing is, NVD CV is an organized database. So if we find a match in the database, it will get reported. If you don't find a match, yeah.
So it's gonna have all four credentials.
This is somewhat required. So CV is not a very organized database. It's organized, but not to high level. So there might be some places where the package name will actually match, but the application will not. So if we say Adobe, then it will be like Adobe Acrobat Reader, but in CV, it will be Adobe Reader. There is a mismatch. Sorry.
Can you be a bit louder, or I can repeat the question? Are you going to talk about how you collect that data from the phone, like you just use the package manager API or something?
That's the beauty of Android. Android has a package manager of itself. You just query it, and you find all the details about the installed applications. We don't have to do the dirty stuff.
Those four credentials are not exactly the same.
Those are actually the same thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So let me be clear on that. You mean hijacking takes place between the client and the server, or before that? No, so it won't let you know about that, but since the package on your device got modified, you have more bad stuff to take care of. Yeah, that's a problem. Just a second. Can we take questions in the end? We'll just go forward with the presentation right now. Thank you.
We'll come up with Secure Me Droid Hijack.
That would be a great idea, sir. Thank you. Summing it up all together, this is the same slide that we talked about in the beginning. We joined all the internals together. So you install the application, you scan the applications on your device using Secure Me Droid, send the data to server, which is not sensitive. You get the results after analysis from the server. Then you decide you want to keep the application, or if it is a safe application, you don't want to do anything with it. I don't think so.
Can you see my thing?
Yeah.
So this is the first stage we talked about, where you are installing. You guys are, I mean, everyone is trying to install, which is our main job for today, and then we can go home. Okay. After installation, these are the four things that we are talking about, like package name, app name, version name, and app version number. Then we are talking about the analysis part. This is where we are checking for vulnerabilities, right? And then finally, we are giving a result. We are giving the user a choice of whether the app is safe or unsafe. And if it's unsafe, these are the three options that can be talked about. Okay? So this is the flow we have basically discussed.
Does that all make sense now, as compared to the beginning part?
So that works as a clicker as well.
I see nodding head, so I'll take that as yes. How many of you have actually heard of Am I Vulnerable? None.
Oh, yeah.
One, two, cool. So those of you who know Am I Vulnerable, we were actually going to present Am I Vulnerable and not Secure Me Droid. So the question arises, what happened to Am I Vulnerable? Am I Vulnerable met a new friend, and that's marketing. That's what happened to Am I Vulnerable, which is not so good version. When we came up with Am I Vulnerable, it was, we found it to be pretty cool. But when we saw Secure Me Droid after marketing, did some rebranding to it, we said that, oh shit, our app sucks. The rebranded version is so cool. And that's what actually happened. So AIV met marketing, marketing rebranded and came up with Secure Me Droid. But if you know AIV and
marketing is inside this house.
So marketing can close their ears. If you talk, if you want to talk about AI V2, we can do that. That's a good part. From our little knowledge, there is none.
Our little knowledge is based on a little friend called Google.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's move with this now.
Any questions so far? Or any other questions? One we have, we probably can take that in.
How many of you are interested in actually seeing the application now? So the thing is, I don't trust internet at conferences, so that's why I have a video, so that it doesn't break. So even if you run it in live on your device, it will actually work in the same manner. So first of all, as I mentioned in the beginning, you have to actually install the application. That's how Secure Me Droid works, and that's dead simple. I assume that you'll do that. And yes, the important part. If you recall from the beginning, I mentioned that there are only two permissions which are required, and this is the proof for it. We actually need only network access and run at startup. That's it. And you'll see actually the application working just with these two permissions. We'll just wait for it. So this is the main UI of the application. You have different options for running the application. Check my apps for checking your application, application settings, or reset Secure Me. If you mess up with the settings, you can actually reset the application and do stuff with it. And let us load the applications that you have. I'll assume that you are not seeing the first application. So it will one thing to note is it only lists the applications which are common and not system applications. So there are like those stage fright stuff in your Android device. System applications don't get listed. So that's a heavy load to test, but let's see. Stuff actually works without it too. This is how the settings are. So in the beginning, I mentioned that we don't actually allow the user to stop the application from working on mobile data and Wi-Fi. But if you still don't want it to run, then you disable the first setting, which is notify me when an application installed or updated. If you disable it, then the application will actually stop scanning for on its own for new installs or updates. This is the scan depth, which Vishal covered. By default, we do medium. So what we have seen is if you scan for a 3-year database, it somewhat covers most of the vulnerabilities that might exist on a device. If you are super crazy and super crazy for security, do the intense. And if you are not so interested in security, go for low.
The idea is that mobile apps are getting updated so often that 3 years is usually a good time to check for.
So some users might not be very comfortable with internal details of the application. In case you don't feel so happy about it, just disable the detailed app info section. You won't get too many internal details about the application then. Again, lazy people can wake up because this is the important feature now. How do you actually enable scheduled scan? As I mentioned in the beginning, we can do that weekly, monthly, or yearly, depending on how you want to configure it. You can set it the way you want, the most comfortable way you think of. The interesting part on which actually the application works, which is scan application. Let's scan one of the application and see what we it gets written. Okay. It's actually working. It's still working. Yep. As I mentioned in the beginning, application name, package name, the version details, and one of the things that we wanted is how the application actually got installed on your device. So if it is from a manager like Play Store, the application can tell you the application was installed from Play Store and not from an APK. And happily, none of the issues were found in this application. Let's do something interesting now. Yes, if you mess up with the settings, this is the way you get it back. So in this part, we are actually installing a new application, which is Adobe Reader. Just a second. Anyone from Adobe here? We are safe. Cool. Let's wait for the application to install right now. This would be fun. Sure. OK. The application actually got installed, and this is the fun part. See, a vulnerability got detected in Adobe Reader 11.1.3, sorry. And see, the CV information. The CV information actually got accessed from our server and got displayed on your screen. If you are super crazy about the details, just go over the CV, click on the CV link, and you'll get further details about it. It is actually very vulnerable. Let's go a bit fast. You can still access those. So when the application actually got installed previously, it got scanned instantly. So you install the application, it gets scanned. Before even you open the application, you have results in front of you. That's the beauty of it. You don't have to actually do it manually. Here I'm doing it manually just for you guys to know about it, that it is actually possible. And yeah, if you are a good guy, you can actually uninstall the application. We'll just skip it. So right now the scan depth has been set to medium, which is 3-year database, and we'll just change it to low, 1-year database, and let's see what happens next. No vulnerabilities. So if you set it to a very low level, like 1-year database, I guess this vulnerability was found in 2014. If you set low, only 2015 database gets scanned. That's why you don't, SecureMeDroid never reported a vulnerability. Does that make sense? Perfect. So in the beginning, it used to scan only one application, but now it can scan all the application at once. So if you want to scan multiple applications, just check them and see. Multiple applications got scanned, so you don't have to go one by one. Someone did. I don't know who. Yeah. Someone was there. Like, I don't know who. Sure. I'll just take that in the end, please. Thank you. Oh, yeah. This is the important part. So we are actually updating Acrobat Reader, in which we found the vulnerability. The application got updated to 15 version. The 15 version is not vulnerable according to CV. That's where the purpose of Play Store comes in. So if you update the application and it is secure, you are safe. And that was to make sure that don't assume that Adobe Reader is vulnerable. We were actually installing a vulnerable application just for the demo. And that was the demo. And let's get back.
Everyone still up? Is it making sense?
Did the video make sense? Thank you. I missed something.
Okay, that's a revision.
Yes, a faster vision. Yeah, since it was started by Vishal, I'd love him to conclude it.
That's the conclusion. Draw your own conclusion, right? So, yes, one of the things is that both of us have had a lot of fun doing this because it started as a side project. It wasn't something which was part of our quote-unquote day-to-day stuff which we were doing. We took, what, about 6 months?
6 months, yeah. We never touched Android for 2 years, and suddenly this idea came in, and we started working on Android after 2 years. That's a hell lot of time.
And interestingly, it gave us a chance to act like a development team. So I took on the role of sort of deciding the roadmap for the product, how we want to build it, what's the core use case we want to have, so on and so forth. And he became the crazy dev, and I also became the in-house QA, right? So often we would fight and we would do funny things, and then by that time, India operations also started having more people. So some of them could not understand because we literally had a code language of talking about AIV, right? So people who are new to the team, they're like, what's up with you guys? Like, let's do this in AIV, AIV has that. And you know, so that was, overall it was a lot of fun. This is the first time where we are officially rolling out this app at any major conference. Okay, so we'd like to thank everyone here in the room for attending our talk. One of the things was that also has a story. So everything we've done about this seemingly small app has, for us, it means it has led to a sort of a bigger story. When we got ready with the alpha version, we started applying for, we basically started responding to CFPs for local conferences in India because of the travel costs involved, right? And somehow we didn't make it for the local conferences, so we were pretty disheartened. We were like, maybe, you know what, maybe we are the only ones who are seeing this as a benefit to the end user. Maybe end users don't care about preventive security, right? And then AppSec CFP happened, AppSec US, and we are like, this is like, whoa, right? Way over the league. But we said, let's give it a shot. We don't know what's going to happen, what's not going to happen. Then one fine day, or it was one evening, I think, evening or late night, both of us get this mail, and we were like, we read that mail like 4 or 5 times. Really? Like, it says, dear Abhini Jairaj, and for me, it's like, dear Vishal, that must be a very misprint. What happened, right? So we were thrilled at this, and now we are thrilled that we have been able to share what we've been doing with all of you. The request is that, needless to say, you must provide feedback, because that's the only way we would know what else needs to be done, or how good or bad or ugly it is. But either ways, if it's good, just let us know you enjoyed it. If it's ugly, send the mail. We'll just delete it, but at least send it. You know, so.
That's the thing is, actually, things improve from feedback. So if there is no feedback, we'll assume that stuff is going good.
Yeah.
If there is feedback, we'll see that we should accept it or not.
Yeah. And yeah, thank you, Slide.
Do you guys have plans to go on platform?
Okay, I'll cover that too.
You can take the mic if you want.
So we did. Yes. Okay, so the question is, do we plan on doing it on iOS and other platforms too? So we did the analysis for iOS. iOS has a major restriction due to which it cannot be implemented on iOS for sure. Windows I'm not sure about, and other platforms really not sure, but iOS and Android are one of the key things, important things, and since we were Android users, here it's for Android. Super thank you for everyone who joined in, and that's really a great feeling to present it before such a great people.
And you didn't collapse.
And I didn't collapse, because this is my first international conference, and I have like serious stage fear.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I don't know whether you noticed this. I was kind of hovering around here because I was worried he's going to fall, right? So he didn't.
Even if I fall, I am pretty sure he's not going to catch me.
Actually. Yes, go ahead.
Question, sir.
Either ways,
yeah. We're going to answer it for sure. Yes, absolutely. Yes, it will. So if you package that application and put fake information inside that package, it will get affected. But the thing is, you are packaging it on your own device. You are the only person who will get affected with it. So the idea is the idea is also get the signature from the application and match it against a database and make sure that if there is a signature match, then it is a legit application and not repackaged. So, which is a pretty good idea. We'll actually look into it, and thank you for that.
Noted.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, sure.
Any other questions? No. Thank you, and you want to say something?
No, I was saying.
Perfect, thank you, and awesome.